I don't have any grievances.
You have a grievance.
No, America, it's not really a thing, okay?
No, I just think it's weird.
Deal about it for like 5 minutes.
I just think it's weird how like you have on the rundown, as our YouTube audience see, the two people that watch. But for our audio listeners, we have the albums and like new songs listed like song first and then the artist, which I disagree with. I don't know. That's just not how I listen to music. When I see this song, or you know, I see like Alicia Keys, Keith Urban, The Speed of Now.
I think we should throw out a disclaimer that Noah uses Apple Music for.
And I think
is that how Spotify does it?
So much.
Well, let's just say this, let's save this for record. I know Spotify is really popular. It's the most popular streaming services. But iTunes was the first way that most of us had us listening to
and
music.
That's cool.
Hold on.
We've graduated.
You graduated.
Hold on.
We recruit out. This. So if books start just doing it from left to right, to go right to left, you're going to start, you know, everything's right to
in
left.
In other
now.
Areas of the world, it is right to left.
That's true.
Exactly. I think that's kind of ethnocentric of you to say.
That's not ethnocentric. You know? I understand there's like that in a lot of areas of the world, but we live in America. Unfortunately, we live in America, which is left to right. And I'm not going to switch the way I read. And I just think it's weird.
Wait, no. Can I actually introduce an actual, like, pre-pod question I wanted to pose, and I sent y'all the tweet. It was like, would you rather a Frank Ocean Andre 3000 collab, J. Cole or Kendrick, Pusha T, Madlib, Kanye, Tyler, The Weeknd, and Drake?
I thought about this.
We already got a Weeknd Drake.
We already got Weeknd and Drake. So,
are you saying Take Care?
Take Care. Yeah,
that's for the most part. Can you name them again? I gotta find a tweet. I remember looking at it though. I actually
Frank
thought
Ocean
about this.
And Andre, I'm gonna resend it. Just, I think that's probably gonna be the smartest thing for us to do.
I mean, it has.
But J. Cole, Kendrick, Pusha T, Madlib, Frank Ocean, Andre 3000. I feel like I've narrowed it down to two.
I don't want J. Cole or Kendrick because like they've teased for so long about that, and at this point, I just don't even want it. So I'm no on that. I'm no on Drake and The Weeknd because we've basically like gotten a lot of collabos with them. So now it's between Frank Ocean, Andre 3000, and Pusha T and Madlib. Now Frank Ocean. And Pusha T and Madlib feel like the one that's be most plausible. Like that's the one that I feel like could actually happen. But it would be interesting just to hear some new Andre 3000 music. So
my vote went straight to Andre 3000 and Frank Ocean. Those are some of the two rarest musicians.
Yeah, I love both retired musicians to come out of retirement and make music again. Yeah,
is Frank Ocean retired? Is that on paper?
Honestly, I don't want Andre 3000 because the first time Andre 3000 comes out, it'd be kind of disrespectful to do a collab with like Frank Ocean, not Outkast. That's like disrespectful. You can't do that. Avery's like, who cares? Big boy, whatever. See, this is disrespect.
We're gonna give some respect to
Big Boy. Big Boy is underrated.
Big Boy is that guy. That's not part of the
that
debate.
That is disrespectful. But those are my top two. I agree. I just feel like the Pusha T and Madlib one would be the most plausible. Like I could actually see that actually happening.
I still want to hear Cole and Kendrick on an album. That'd be fun.
That's what I like. I feel like you disrespected the sentiment of that. Like I would
You know what I'm scared though? I'm scared if it happened, it'd be like old songs. I just don't feel like it'll happen. I just don't feel like it'll never happen. Because remember they said it was coming out like 2013, 2012. It's like, oh, it's coming out. Like, okay. And then they did
those two tracks.
Two songs, and they was making and they was like taking little hits. He was like, okay, you know, they're just kind of teasing us, and then no music, so.
Okay. Well, without further ado,
welcome to the 97 Demo Podcast,
where we give you the latest in music, news, and much more along the way. I'm 1-3 of your hosts, Nnamdi Agwanwu, joined by
Avery. Why don't you go ahead first?
I'm Avery.
Why can't it be seamless? This was y'all's idea.
Noah McGee, what's up, guys? It is a beautiful
Nnamdi
Sunday.
Wants us to be more enthusiastic, Noah.
Yeah,
I just feel like it's never a seamless transition.
It is a beautiful Sunday morning. Well, actually, it's kind of cloudy outside where I'm at.
Yeah, it's kind of cloudy over here in Chicago. The Midwest.
Describe the scenery.
In Chi City, but...
Chi City.
Never mind.
We're getting ready for some rain later today here in
It's probably going to rain here in Chicago.
Rain here in the New York City tri-state area.
I just cracked my phone 30 minutes ago.
Congrats.
I mean, it happens, y'all, at this point. Like, I should have cracked my phone so many times. I treat my phone like crap. I throw that thing all around the place. I throw the thing all around the place.
My screen time was down by 50% this week. You guys proud?
No, because you were probably just using it. No, all that screen time was just on the computer or the TV. So
no, it counts. It counts the computer.
I don't know how it was possible, but somehow
I did it.
Oh. You guys, I just had to do surgery to basically charge all of my devices at once, and that's why I'm trying to be proud of me. But okay, like let's go ahead and, for the sake of time, let's hop into charts rundown, you guys.
Yeah, because people are busy.
You know, I'm just gonna look at you and laugh.
let's zoom through the Hot 100 because literally did nothing change from last.
Okay, nothing changed in the Hot 100, but I do think it's worth saying. Shout out to 4 weeks at number one. Out of the 6 weeks, it's been on the chart. 4 weeks, it's been at number one. Now Cardi B is longest number one, and more than 2.5.
Wait, whoa!
I admit every week. I have to hold on to that.
This is Cardi B's. Hold on. This Cardi B's longest number one. Are you serious?
Yeah, it did more than Bodak Yellow. 4 weeks at number one.
I got nothing to say. I just let the numbers.
I feel like I don't have to carry the burden of being wrong about WAP every single pod. I admitted to it back in when did it come out? May, June, perhaps. July, maybe. When did it come out?
July, August.
I'm ready to move forward with my, you know, it was the wrong prediction.
Well, we are not on it.
Anyway, that's pretty much it. Mood by 24K Golden, still at number six. We wanted that one to move in the top five. Didn't happen though. BTS still holding at number two with Dynamite. Honestly, download released in the U.S.
Until another big artist comes out with like a poppin' single, that top five kind of look like kind of locked down. Maybe BTS might leave a little bit, maybe, but I don't even know. Like that kind of top five kind of feel like locked down.
That's like it's been they've been there for a while. All of those songs have been there for a while. NBA YoungBoy came out with his album and he has a couple songs that debuted here on the Hot 100.
I told y'all. Remember we did that mid-year thing and we was like, y'all don't underestimate NBA YoungBoy, and he did numbers. He did numbers.
He did do numbers, but he has a couple of songs on here at 35 and 44. And there, 77, Dead Trolls.
He got a lot of songs. Oh, my goodness. He got a lot of songs on here.
Other things I noted, Savage is leaving the top 40 after 27 weeks. Well, it's at 40, so I'm assuming next 40, week, unless top it, like, 40. London jumps up, it's probably going to, you know, which is, like, kudos to that. It's very impressive.
Yeah.
And Hit Different went from 29 to 70. I'm kind of really sad about that.
Oh, wow.
Did you guys listen to the version without Ty Dolla Sign?
I did.
I like the version with Ty Dolla Sign. Why are y'all bullying him?
I like
I just like the version without him better.
I like the version without Ty Dolla Sign.
I was like, dang, this should have been the single.
Hopefully it sounds better on the album. We'll see.
I agree.
We'll see. We'll see. Well, over on the Billboard 200, NBA YoungBoy, number one, his album sold 127,000 first week. Top. Top was at the top of the charts, if you feel me.
Yeah, Top. That's the name of the album, people. Top.
It's the biggest debut for him, and he's now the fastest artist to earn three number one albums since BTS.
Oh, so, that's probably not surprising considering he released like three albums a year. So that's not surprising.
Don't
that's not a bad thing. I'm not bashing him. Yo, I gave him respect because I was like, because we were like, oh my gosh, he's gonna do numbers. I was like, y'all remember we did that mid year thing, and he does numbers. We were surprised by how much people listen to him. So that's pretty cool.
You want to talk about not moving? Number two and three here, Pop Smoke, Shoot for the Stars, Aim for the Moon, then Juice WRLD, Legends Never Die, still just sitting at two and three, which, again, I think is very impressive.
Yeah. Two posthumous albums.
Two posthumous albums, yes.
I mean, I think that's an important thing to say, but yeah, man, people really love them. And, you know, if it's their last art, like a lot of people's favorite artist's last album, that's going to be the album that most people are going to. But even new people, too. It's like, oh, that artist died. I mean, it's that album.
Let me ask you guys a question, specifically you, Avery. Do you remember what album was in the top five here that is no longer anywhere near the top five? Does anyone remember?
Oh, is it? It's a. Oh my gosh, it's a country artist. Or no, it was
not country.
No, it was was it Metallica?
No, it was Metallica.
No.
They were in here somewhere.
I'm pretty sure it was number four.
Some old band.
No, it was an old band.
No,
I don't remember them. Who was it?
Tattletales by 6ix9ine dropped from number four to seven.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
That took a little tumble. Number my goodness. Seven now.
Jesus.
Oh, wait. Did you try 60? Maybe it was a typo. 60?
Yeah.
There we go.
60. Wow.
I remember because like Metallica was there like 2 weeks ago and now they're like nowhere.
Yeah, they were here.
So, is that surprising?
I forgot. 6ix9ine?
No,
not to bash him, just the idea that his whole thing was like being viral, you know, is it, and
well, viral is a really if we're talking about viral is a really short-term thing anyway, so,
very temporal. Yeah,
so
at some point you have to people have to like what you're doing.
And Noah, Conway the Machine is on here, 126. I feel like you'd be interested in that. Conway the Machine.
Are you serious? That's kind of, yeah, kind of surprising, actually.
I feel like we never give the bottom 100 enough like love.
Oh, my God. Yeah. Is this his first entry?
No, it's re-entry.
No, re-entry.
Oh, okay. I thought it was re-entry.
Yeah, but look, the bottom 100 sheds a lot of light on like some of the albums that I've just been able to like. They're steady and stable. Like people, they're people's go-tos, you know? I mean, some of these have been here forever.
Yeah, like Dreamville. Like,
Forest Hill Drive and Damn are both still on here at 99 and 100.
Yeah.
The Eminem show.
Eminem,
I mean, these are the most popular albums. Like, look, Thriller has been on here who knows how long. I mean,
136 weeks.
No Pressure by Logic is back on. We reviewed that. Check that episode out, guys. No Pressure. Yeah, man. I mean, that's really interesting. Yeah, I do feel like we should give more attention to the bottom 100.
Maybe we
100.
Should do an episode on that one day.
The bottom 100?
Like, what are the albums that have been, like, just
that is interesting.
100? Like, and because there's some albums that have been out for, they're very old albums that are
no,
still
yeah,
just,
they're
like,
always old albums. Look at
Graduate. Y'all, I don't want to say this was us, but we did an episode on Graduation.
And look what happens.
I mean, 97
demo. And apparently, y'all keep joking about this. I stand this last guy at number 200 now. I mean, I don't
that's
know.
Your guy.
Noah
might single-handedly be keeping Bryson Tiller in the top
200. I think that. Honestly, Avery,
I can't even lie. Hold on. I can't even lie. Last night, I was on YouTube and his recommended pop up, and he made a music video for a song that came out 5 years ago. So I was like, yo, so I went down to Bryson Tiller Hole last night. I can't even lie.
It's on tape now.
But I'm not. You can never deny. You're a
okay,
stan.
You know
own it.
I'm a fan. I'm a fan. Okay, I'm a big fan. Okay, I like him. Okay, I like him.
Thank
I like
you,
him a lot.
How do
I like
you?
Him
I
lot.
Know.
Nothing wrong with that. We're just saying you just deny it. And now,
well, I don't deny it. I'm not in love with this music. I only love that one album. That's it. I don't like that last album. That
I mean, he only has like one album. He has two.
No, he had the second one, but no one really remembers it. There's a reason why he's been putting so much focus on Trap Soul.
Yeah, he's like, let me go back to this last album.
He's like, here's a deluxe of my debut album, and I'm like, wait, what did you have a?
That's annoying. I hate that.
I mean, it's kind of a good idea though.
Oh well, no,
because people
not.
Love
no,
the album. So.
Yeah, but we want new music.
Okay, upcoming debuts. Let's see. The biggest thing I could see interrupting is Alicia Keys' album. Which was, did y'all listen? It was really good. I listened to it.
I still haven't listened.
I haven't gotten around to it yet.
I saved it. It was one of those albums, like, you know, you save and you're like, wow, these features look awesome. Because I saw Tierra Whack was on there. Who else was on there? Name people, Nnamdi. I know there was some other great artists on there. Jesus, Nnamdi.
No, you put me on the spot. No, no,
I know,
it was
like
Tierra Whack was on there. You know, it was also.
Hold on, I got you. Sampho was on there. Miguel.
Sampho.
Snow Allegra.
On there, you know,
Snow Allegra was on there.
Khalid was on there. I remember that.
Yeah, that was one.
Oh, and Jill Scott. There was a Jill Scott song.
Jill Scott.
Sorry,
that makes
so
sense.
You just had to give me a second.
Also,
probably interrupting. Holy Avery. Even though I know Tierra to Stain, I can see that happening. Top five, top three, maybe number one.
Congratulations to Mr. Bieber and Mr.
Y'all think it will be number one? Y'all think Coley will be number one?
I don't see why. I don't. It, you know, if it got a big, a lot of people were listening to it.
They were pushing
and there's
it.
Not really any other new songs.
I don't
think
competing
top
against.
Top 10.
It's competing against like a 7 week old song though. So I feel like if it has enough momentum with its debut, maybe.
Maybe.
Or maybe number two. I can see it coming at number two.
Top five for sure.
But
top
like, WAP is just like it's a better song. And two, like,
I think about
quotable.
It all day. I think about it all day. I'm not gonna lie.
Ooh, Noah, you're working.
Well, I'm talking about the beat. Oh my God, I'm talking about the beat though. Don't that beat? Don't y'all? And the little samples, like there's some in this.
Yeah,
you know, people,
no, that's great.
It's
a catchy song all around.
Catchy song. So
are we expecting Baby Keem to chart somewhere?
Oh yes, he is.
No, don't
he should
that
have
much pressure.
Yo, I'm surprised he don't have that many followers on Instagram. He's got like 100,000. Like I'm saying the top 100. I think he's making top 100.
I hope so.
I could see Diamonds by Sam Smith debuting somewhere in the top like 30.
And said some too by Moneybagg Yo.
Me Gusta, the song Cardi B featured on it by Anita and Mickey.
Oh, Mike Towers. Is it Mike Towers?
Mike Towers.
I think Mike Towers. Mike Towers.
I could see that doing well as well. So I guess we'll see what happens next week. New releases, y'all. I guess the focus for us for sure was Soligen, which, by the way, love the name. Love the name.
This looks like this is going to be our review next week.
Yeah. Because, you guys,
Well, I just want to say I'm excited about that because, you know, we haven't got a lot of time to listen to albums. We do album reviews. It's a really quick turnaround, so I feel like we really get to get into this. But
this is something that needs to be, like, listened to a lot, too.
Yeah, yeah, for sure. I agree.
But just off a couple of days, let me tell you.
I've only heard a couple songs, but I haven't listened to the whole thing in totality.
I saw a lot of albums come out this week. We had a lot of albums come out.
Wow, ASAP Ferg came out. I didn't even know.
Apparently,
hold on. Apparently, he's not ASAP anymore. Seriously, apparently he's just Ferg.
Yeah, I know. I heard.
You know, hey, look. I think they're just having a little interfamily, interpersonal conflict. They'll get it. We all have our family disputes.
You are true. You are correct.
You know,
Lil Peep, who also is a rapper that died a couple of years ago. Correct. Mm-hmm. How many? 2018.
Yeah,
I believe. He died recently. I'm not familiar with his music. I don't know if this is his first posthumous release since that time. Avery, are you familiar?
No, he's had a... I think this is not his first posthumous release. I know.
Okay, gotcha. Okay, that's interesting.
I know pacing for number one is probably going to be Nectar, Joji, Tickets to My Downfall, MGK, and I believe, what was the third one MGK. That they said could, like... But I'm just saying. Oh, and I think Folklore or something like those.
No,
are
no,
really
no. It's
racing
cool.
For number one next week.
It's just MGK. I didn't.
Did you guys listen
Who's
to
doing rock,
albums?
And I think is very much good for him.
Honestly, y'all, I did not listen to a lot of new albums this week. Honestly, I'm not even gonna lie. I listened to a lot of new music, like singles and stuff like that. But I still want to listen to Action Bronson, obviously. Spilligian.
Public Enemy. Is that a new Public Enemy album?
Oh, yes, it is. Because he was on.
What?
I know that because he was on NBA Inside the NBA and he was doing interviews. Like, yeah, I got a new album. I was like, oh, wow.
It's awesome.
I had no idea.
That is awesome, actually.
I'm going to listen to that.
I listened to the Joji album and the Neighborhood album, and I really enjoyed both. I almost made the Neighborhood album like my project of the week, but I didn't.
Joji? What genre is she?
He's part of like 88 Rising with like Rich Brian and Nicki and all them. And
So it's a rap. He's a rap artist.
He's like a singer. He's more of a singer. I really don't know how to like describe his music. It's like
are his songs on TikTok.
One of them was, but not from this album. This is like a new album.
All right, I know what kind of artist he is. Don't worry.
So many more singles came out. So many more singles from Big Guys That Fool came out this week too. But did y'all listen to Franchise?
Oh yeah, we did.
Travis Scott, Young Thug, MIA.
The best part of the song is low-key MIA.
People are making fun of her on Twitter for her feature.
Are you serious? No, is that a real take?
No, that's not a real take.
I like MIA.
I do like MIA. Yeah, I like MIA. It's kind of interesting she came out of nowhere for this feature.
There was something.
Well,
there
this is the thing.
I don't think it was as bad as everyone made fun of her for. But like,
no one on the song was that good.
It's the style of rap. I feel like it's that style of rap.
I agree.
Paired with like this beat.
I don't know. The song was kind of just mid. It didn't make me feel any kind of way. I was just so like, oh, this is so like mid for me. It was like nothing great, nothing bad. It was just like, oh, okay. And the features were just kind of like, why were they on there?
Was cool.
That was the only good thing.
That was it. Yeah, that was the only cool
Which
thing
is like, that brings the question is, and I think I asked Avery this.
Oh,
yeah, you asked me this
last time. Is Travis Scott approaching the level of like Kanye expectation where it's like, watched you for
We're
your
not going to do that.
Well, no. Listen, I'm not saying they're on the same stature, but as far as expectations, when Kanye drops something, we know the bars aren't going to be great.
Let me say this.
Production. Is that Travis now?
Let me say this. There's two kind of people, okay? Let me say this. Because I feel like with Kanye, there's people who are Kanye stans and people who are like, wow, I genuinely like his music a lot. Like, I genuinely feel like his music has been stellar. I feel like the people with Travis Scott, the fans are so loud about how great Travis Scott is. They're going to be so loud. And I feel like this kind of mixed reviews from everybody else who's like outside the Travis Scott stan fan camp. You know what I'm saying? So I don't know. I don't know if he's reached that level. In his own way, maybe, because his fans love him so much that everything he puts out is such a like big deal. But I don't know if it's like that overall, because I feel like Kanye has reached a point where like outside of the people who are just big fans have been like, wow, he really makes incredible music. So it's kind of different levels, but I get what you're saying. but yeah, I guess.
I mean, I hope this isn't a single. Like, I hope if he's coming out with a new project sometime soon, whenever that is, I hope this song is not.
It's called Franchise, and we had the McDonald's deal. I feel like that's connected somehow.
Yeah, I feel you.
I don't know if this is like an album thing, you know?
Is Travis Scott selling out?
No. Get your bag while you can. I would never shame someone for doing that. At the end of the day, it worked. I doubted it. I doubted the collab when I first came
out. I agree. No, we're not saying. I was just. We don't. I don't want to stay on this, but I'll leave it. I'll leave it for.
No, don't leave it. We're a music pod.
No, I don't want. I don't want to get stuck on this.
Remember the feedback we got.
Oh, that's true. You're right.
Come on, there you go.
It's just I was listening to something and they were talking about how Travis Scott is like. You know, he's such a big artist. And, you know, in hip-hop sometimes, I don't want to get all weird with this, but, you know, hip-hop, there's this big thing about, did this artist sell out? Like, is he doing this? And, like, McDonald's is, like, the most... I know we talked about this another way. McDonald's is the most, like, poppy, most popular, doing it for the money type thing in the world. And, you know, with the rap, it's like, oh, he's doing it for the money. He's selling out. That's kind of, like, the thing. So I was just wondering. Yeah. I was like, I don't know. I don't necessarily see it selling out. I don't see it personally as selling out, but it's, like... That's a question that aren't some people says like, is Travis Scott?
I feel like if Travis Scott acted like he was cut from that cloth, then maybe, but he doesn't.
He doesn't. You know? That's the thing. He just like, it doesn't come off that way.
Which also throwback to our sorry, Avery. I'm talking so much. Go ahead.
I was saying, don't you have to like in order to sell out? Don't you have to like compromise some quality?
And yeah, I
agree. While I don't think Travis Scott has been the most consistent artist either. So like. I don't think he's compromising sort of quality. He has been either like hit or miss over his whole career anyway.
And I feel like his music, although it's like people love it, I don't feel like it's been in like such a like underground type way. You know, that's what I really feel like when he's selling out. It's like, oh, wow, he sounded like this. And then he got popular and he sounds like this. I feel like he's kind of sounded the same.
Yeah. But y'all know what I'm going to do, what I'm going to slide in here and say, throwback to our last episode. I credit this part of the reason for artists, rappers are allowed to do this is because gangster rap isn't the thing, and we had Kanye come in and let rappers who clearly weren't cut from that like cloth like come in and rap and do the thing. And I feel like this is more accepted in this generation of rap because of that.
I agree.
Like if straight early 2000, maybe you'd have a point.
Yeah, you know? I agree. No, I agree with that. But I think it's also the type of artist too, like the fact that he came in like you know like that. Like if Will Smith was rapping and he had a McDonald's true. Collab, we wouldn't be surprised, would we? Yeah. I'd be like, so
Loki, no, he absolutely. Probably did have a McDonald's.
Yeah, but I also listened to The Reason. Both The Reason songs were really great with Vince Staples. It's good to see Vince Staples back out. We need more music from him, too.
Yeah.
Both The Reason songs were good. So
how are like the Bryson Tiller songs? No.
Well, first of all, I didn't listen to this one for the record. Wow. But I didn't. Actually, I did. Oh, actually, I did. A lot. I did. I'm like, yeah, okay, right, I did. It wasn't that great, honestly, in my opinion. My R&B, like, I've grown so much about, like, my R&B music. It's grown so much, like, over the last 5 years that my expectations for R&B music has, like, grown so much. Like, I really want good singing. You know what I'm saying? He's not a bad singer, but he's not a great singer either. So, I really want good singing now with an R&B artist. So.
Okay. Anything else that we want to highlight of the many new releases we have? Oh, No One's in the Room by Jessie Reyes was a great song. I wanted to sneak that in there. But anything else you guys want to add?
It's just so funny. Machine Gun Kelly and Halsey did a song together. Cause remember they had a beef with like G-Eazy and MGK and Eminem. They're all connected.
They're not even dating anymore, right?
No, I know, but it was just funny now. Cause G-Eazy's probably in the corner.
That's how you feel.
That's how you feel.
Now it's time for me to get mad. So Billboard Music Award nominees. Oh, cause there's so many. Like literally this entire headline block is like I'm mad. Like everything. All right. One, the Billboard Music Awards, they were delayed. Because my first question when I saw this was, why is an award show in which the tracking period is literally all 2019 happening almost at the end of 2020? It's why, like, when you read who has the nominations, you're kind of like, what? It got pushed back from April to November, so that's one thing. As far as the actual nominees go, it's fine. It's just all of these songs and artists were so long ago, the releases here that are highlighted, that it's like, it's hard to... still I care like this is all for this isn't even Taylor Swift for Folklore, that's her for like Lover, this is like Billie Eilish for whatever that album, like this is all just so like Like, Lil Nas X is like one of them, has like 8 nominees. It's like he hasn't released anything this year.
It's the baby for like 2 albums ago.
But that's still equal. Top artist, Billie Eilish, Jonas Brothers, Khalid, Post Malone, Taylor Swift. Top new artist, DaBaby, Billie Eilish, Lil Nas X, Lizzo, Roddy Ricch. And those are the only 2 big ones.
I feel like I can name the winner of each of these categories already. Yeah. Based off like the past year and who's won the awards already. You know what I'm saying?
This new artist thing is hilarious. Like, top, they're all like
Billie Eilish. Like, Billie Eilish probably won top artist and top new artist, probably. Seriously.
Yeah.
If we're going off last year.
I can see Lil Nas X coming out with top new artist.
No, but remember she got like everything, swept the Grammys, like the big categories. I could see her like just doing the same thing with this. You know what I'm saying?
Oh, well, no. I'm pretty sure one good thing about the Billboard Awards is they base it off of
strictly chart
stuff, I think.
Yeah. Yeah.
So low key, we probably could guess who's getting what here.
Like, if we are the Billboard podcast, so
I don't like that because the kids, like, I don't know, I don't want to claim that.
No, we're not, but us, so. No, that's
it's
true.
It's funny how, like, on your top new artist, you're like least famous, or like probably like the least high profile one is Lil Nas X. Like, everyone there is so massive now,
yeah,
because of just how long it's been.
Unfortunate with Lil Nas X, the song is bigger than him. I don't think that's the wrong thing to say. He's big, right, but right. The song is bigger than him. The song was freaking huge. I mean,
yeah, it was.
So yeah. I mean, how do you guys feel about this? The fact that it's been so long with these artists coming out and they're doing this now, like, how do you feel like they should have done? Like, when was the one last year? What time of the year was it last year? Was it last year in April? Was that when it was?
No, this was supposed to be April, like last April.
No, I know it was supposed to be last April. What was the last Billboard Awards? Like, what time did it happen last year in 2019?
I think it normally happened spring. Yeah.
So,
which makes a little bit more sense because at that point you have like Grammys, Emmys, all those things are like, they're based off of 2019. So it's like fine.
Yeah,
but this being in November, it's like,
yeah, my problem is less with the fact that they pushed it back because a lot of people didn't know what they were doing. Like, a lot of things have been delayed, obviously, in music. But I don't know. My problem is, I guess, with like, it's been so long. I don't know if that's their fault though. Like, I don't know what they were supposed to do, but like, I feel like they could have done a war show based off like stuff that's come out after April from that year. And I don't know. How do you guys feel about it?
I guess the argument is like, if they would have shifted it back. Oh, don't, we're getting there, Avery. It's like, if they would have pushed this back, it would have impacted all the award shows to come. So I get like at least the tracking period. If they would have included things from this year, like that would have changed like future periods. So I get that. I also find it curious, like they didn't do, maybe because of how, when it was like April versus June, the BET Awards, they just went virtual. But I guess maybe this was too close to the actual, like, everything getting crazy for them to think, like, okay, let's. They would have been the first, I think.
Yeah, it would have been the first. Yeah, so I don't know. Let's just get to it.
Avery, what were you, want to go through what you were highlighting earlier?
Yeah, so I was just scrolling through the list of nominees here, and I see top gospel artists, and you see your, Kirk Franklin, you see Corin Hawthorne, Tasha Cobbs Leonard, and then you get to the last one.
Oh, don't forget Sunday Service Choir.
Are they 2 separate things?
Wait a second, hold up. Oh my gosh.
Wow. So the final,
hold on.
So the final 2 nominees here.
If this is true. This is trash. I can't do it.
No,
I can't.
So the either final
can't,
one.
I can't.
The final 1 or 2 here are the Sunday Service Choir and Kanye West.
Yeah, no, exactly.
It's because they both had 2 individual records. Kanye had, what was that album? Jesus is King.
Jesus
and then
is
the
King.
Sunday Service Choir, I remember they put out an actual release later that year. So Sunday Service Choir deserves to be nominated because that's just
Okay.
My problem is Jesus is King is not... Hold on, this artist,
okay. Yeah.
Am I off kilter there? Like, I feel like I listened to the album just once, so maybe it didn't grasp me. But upon my first listen, yes, he says God throughout, but is that the criteria for a gospel album? Like, to me, just wanting the press, I feel like Kanye did sell the best out of these nominees probably because he's Kanye. Like, he's probably got, like, if Kanye sweeps this awards, these categories, what does that say to the actual other artists who do this, you know?
I should mention he's also nominated for Top Christian Artist.
Yeah, for the record, I want to say this. For the record, I don't have a problem with him being nominated for Top Christian Artist. I don't have a problem with that. Because if a rap artist, like a Lecrae, even though he normally does that, if released a great... Because at the Grammys, you don't see it on TV, he always sweeps like the Christian, you know, the Christian awards, you know, in terms of Grammys. So he did a Christian... I mean, Kanye, I can't say he didn't do a Christian album. He did a Christian album. He was talking about Christianity. Even though it wasn't good to me, it wasn't that deep.
No, but he was did that. It a he Christian did. Album?
I mean...
Like, I listened to it once. I'm genuinely asking, like, was it?
technically, right?
I say technically, yes. I mean, he was talking about it. I'm not going to say he got deep into it. It wasn't anything groundbreaking or anything, but I'm going to say he did it. It was very
Close
surface
that
level.
Sunday, you're my Chick-fil-A.
Well, I know. It was very surface level. It wasn't that great, but he did it. So I don't mind him being top Christian artist. The thing I have with the gospel artist thing is that's not gospel music. He did a Christian rap album. It's not gospel. He sampled gospel music. He sampled it, which a lot of rappers do. But he did a Christian rap album. He did not do a gospel album. Kanye West was not singing like Kurt Franklin on a dang album. He wasn't. He had a Sunday service choir in the background behind rap beats. Like, that's exactly. That's a Christian rap album. I have a problem with that. So I have no problem with the top Christian artist thing because he did a Christian album, which is like, whatever. But he probably is going to win it, which is unfortunate in my opinion, because it feels like he just took over the whole genre. That's just my opinion. But he said he did a gospel album, which he didn't. It's not a gospel album. It's not. He used gospel samples. Rappers do that all the time. Like, come on now.
So top R&B album, Changes by Justin Bieber is nominated. That makes sense because the tracking period, I think, is March to March. So that, I think that just...
So he's also nominated for top Christian album and top gospel album.
Yeah.
Too.
I don't mind him being on the Christian album, gospel album. I just don't, he shouldn't be in there at all. At all. Yeah. But he'll probably win it, so.
And he's literally 2 out of the 5 nominees. Yeah. So.
He'll probably win it, so. Yeah.
Anyways, do we want to keep moving on?
Let's keep moving on.
Yeah, for the sake of time, let's get, because this is just, we'll watch when this happens. Are there any predictions we really want to make, or are we that invested?
We're not that invested.
It feels so long ago. That's fair. Like, who that's cares? Fair.
No, we're not. No, let's be true. We're not that invested. This was like a year and a half ago this music came out. We're not that invested.
Okay, so next story, Meg Thee Stallion got a time.
My God. Hold on. Look at this top gospel song.
Whew. For the
four
record,
of the 5 nominees are Kanye for Closed on Sunday, Follow God, On God, and Salah.
This is a big problem. I have a big issue with this, but that's another conversation for another
time. I just want to say, I remember when Kanye said he was coming out with a gospel album, and I saw that it was registered as a gospel album. I remember specifically saying, oh, this is irritating because this is gonna happen. They're gonna be like, he has a top gospel album of the year. He's probably gonna start sweeping awards. You know, just kind of, it's gonna be another genre that he can kind of take over it when he's not like, this is kind of.
It's just the problem when artists who actually make gospel music is actually, and people are like, oh, well, don't get on him because he's just made a, it's not a gospel album. He's not singing. He's not making, he's a rap artist that sampled gospel music. That's not a gospel album. That's not a gospel album. If a rapper samples a rock songs, they're not gonna be like, oh, look, I made a rock album. No, you didn't. You sample rock song. No, it's not a rock. It's not a rock album. It's not a gospel album. So,
hey, I just noticed this, and this isn't the pod. Have you noticed how top Christian song is a category and top gospel song is a category? And the thing that pretty much diminishes them is that top gospel is all black artists and top Christian is predominantly like Christian and gospel mean the exact same thing, but they still are like gospel is Christian.
Yeah, it's interesting. Like, but gospel is a thing with mostly black artists, but my problem is like it's all Kanye and Kirk Franklin.
Is the actual title of gospel more associated with like black?
I don't know, like, but I just think it's just like a cultural thing. Well, let's not get stuck on this.
We're all about intersections.
I love God, but we're not a gospel.
Okay, you're right.
Podcast.
Let's go. So let's go to Meg. We haven't even gotten to our main topic. Oh my gosh. Yeah, so Meg Thee Stallion got a Time magazine cover, which was the great news that we were able to celebrate her this this week before some
the Time 100s always does a great job with it feels like we feel like Time is this old magazine, but they kind of do a good job of saying exactly what's going on, which obviously they're Time.
And so. I think Taraji P. Henson wrote her little blurb here about Meg Thee Stallion, which was really cool too.
Did you read it, Avery? I haven't got a chance to read.
Yeah.
I haven't got a chance to read all of the ones I love. Like, I read Dwayne Wade and Gabrielle Union's, which is great. Mm-hmm. There were a lot of great ones. Obviously, RBG, a lot of good ones. But this is just right on the money, honestly. From like Hot Girl Summer, it's like her influence
been
is
just
kinda,
like ascending for 2 years now. It's kind of crazy.
And that's the thing I want to, like, this is so deserved because her rise has been, especially because I think it's personal because she kind of popped when we graduated. So I kind of feel like, it seeing her rise and how much she's grown since then has almost been inspirational.
I agree. And I like that it's not like, oh, she had a couple hot songs. It was like her influence on like what people were doing. Like Hot Girl Summer was literally what that literally was the whole summer last year. That's like literally heard that every day. So
she's number one on the chart right now.
Right now. It's both. So I have to respect that. So yeah. Shout out to Meg Thee Stallion.
Love Meg. And an unfortunate story that shouldn't even be a story that I snuck in just to touch on because I don't want to validate the other part of the story.
Yeah.
But we're a music podcast and I feel like we have to somehow let me just say without even saying his name. I don't want to the cover of that album. I don't want to listen to that album. No part. Because the fact that this was the method of response that was chosen for this situation, I can't even, yeah. I don't want to touch it.
Yeah, I don't want to touch it either. And,
let's scroll down. We're going to have to
We have to scroll down. Yeah, I'm kind of, this is the thing.
I'm just going to go back.
And this is also the thing too, Nnamdi. I agree with you totally. And it's kind of a thing like we don't want to give attention to the bad that this person has done. You know, it's kind of like as journalists, you don't want to give a bad to this attention. But it's a story and we want to give support to Megan. She it was like a medical report came out that her story is confirmed. She was shot in the foot twice. Right?
Which we shouldn't have even needed it.
There should no longer be doubt about this. And yeah. and anyone who chooses to believe music over a medical report is just there's nothing I can really do or say.
Well, Nnamdi, you can't believe the man, the medical report. They got a hand on everything. Like you can't trust them.
Yeah.
You can't do that.
Oh my god.
I mean, also the timing of when he decided
they're just
to
professionals.
Drop his album.
They're just professionals.
Given the verdict we got this week in
the Breonna Taylor case, it really emphasized
the lack of like respect that Black women get in this country, the lack of belief that goes around Black women's stories. It was just all around disrespectful, all around misogynistic, just all around a terrible situation.
Or just like it's so upsetting.
We got it. Let's not get started.
Let's not get started. But it's so upsetting.
We have
a
thoughts,
better story. Absolutely. Kanye is giving good music artists at least a share of their masters that he owned.
I hope this is true.
I hope it's true too because the tweet's different than it. Does he have the? Can he do that? One like
can he do that?
If he can and he did, then that's like amazing. So.
I mean, it's so funny because last week, you kind of said like, hey, Kanye, you got these people under contract. You're getting mad about you under contract. You got all these artists under contract. What about them?
Yeah.
I mean, he tweeted it. We don't know if it's true, but that would be interesting because I remember Big Sean Colty was like, hey, that would actually help.
And designer. A lot of people, owning your masters is huge.
Designer.
So, like, if Kanye West, one thing I'll say about what he's doing, if he is serious about, I want to change the music industry and I want y'all to see, I'll be the fully transparent horse for y'all to see. So we can have some real change and I'll be a man of my word and give my artists their masters too. This is actually a good news story for Kanye. We don't get those that often. So, kudos to him if it's a real thing.
Kudos to him. Yeah. And this last thing right here. When did this drop,
Avery? I gotta get mad again.
probably the beginning of last week.
So,
the middle of last week.
So Rolling Stone re-released or updated their 500 greatest albums of all time. They originally did this list, 2003, Avery? 2003? Yes. They originally did this list in 2003, which, for the record, it was just like a lot of white people on the list. That's just a fact. It was just a lot of white people on the list. It was, and I'm pretty sure somebody actually tweeted that out too. But so they updated their 500 greatest albums of all time, which, you know, includes your normal, Rolling Stone. Who else was on here? The Beatles, Michael Jackson,
Led Zeppelin was on here a lot.
Led Zeppelin was on here a lot. The Beach Boys.
You want to just go to top 100 or top 10 or something? And just,
okay. Yeah,
oh, Lord. You should have done this on Google Chrome. This could destroy your computer, Avery. But, they basically just re-released their top 500 albums of all time. And they also included some new artists on here, like Tierra Whack was on here. Who else was on here that was recent?
SZA was on here.
Her was on here. Solange.
Frank Ocean.
Kendrick Lamar. Kanye. So it was a lot of artists.
Okay, so I'll do it.
Nnamdi, go ahead.
There were some glaring omissions on this list.
How about we go through the top 10 first?
Okay, so number 10, we had Lauryn Hill, The Miseducation of Lauryn Hill. Number 9 was Bob Dylan, Blood on the Tracks. Number 8 was Prince, Purple Rain.
Yep.
Number 7 was Fleetwood Mac, Rumors. Mm-hmm. Number 6 was Nevermind by Nirvana.
I just listened to that the other day. That album's great.
It's incredible. Number 5, The Beatles, Abbey Road. Number 4, Stevie Wonder, Songs in the Key of Life.
Incredible.
3 is Joni Mitchell, Blue. Number two was Pet Sounds by the Beach Boys. And number one was What's Going On by Marvin Gaye.
For the record, I agree with this number one wholeheartedly. This is the greatest album of all time, in my opinion. This is my favorite album of all time, in my opinion. But that's just me, in my personal.
Well, look, I don't think I would argue with the top 10, 20, or 30 of this list, because I think there are just classics that have shifted the music industry that I honestly probably am not old enough or knowledgeable enough to even comment on. So I won't try. Like, you're never going to see me argue about Marvin Gaye, What's Going On, to be number one on this list. So I have no anger towards the top 100 of this list. I'll even say the top 100.
Yeah.
There was some glaring omissions to this on this list. And look, let me take off my journalism hat, and I'll put on my, you know, casual music
fan of music hat. Fan of music.
Fan of music hat. J. Cole was not one of the 500 albums on this list for Still Drive. And let me tell you what I think the problem is with that. I'm gonna say it. You guys.
Uh-oh.
500 albums. Let me say something about this list. They did a good job at including a lot of great albums, and I can pick 75 to 100 that Forest Hill Drive should be here over.
Uh-oh.
While you get, I don't understand why Fine Line, which came out this year, and okay, yeah, Watermelon Sugar is a hit, is on this list, and Forest Hill Drive isn't. Then it made me think, why is J. Cole so often, of the big three rap artists, right now at least, one who gets snubbed so often? Oh. And I have to think, it harkened back to our last conversation. No, I'm not going to do it. Don't worry.
I don't want to argue about that.
We're not going to do it. But I remember
I agree with you. I agree with you, for the record.
I know. And I started thinking, and I was like, you know, Kendrick is on here three times. Good Kid, M.A.A.D City, Damn, to Pimp a Butterfly.
That's crazy.
Drake is on here. Kanye is on here three times.
Drake's on here twice for an album that shouldn't even be on here.
Hold on. But wait, what's Kanye? Do we know what Kanye's here for? It's like My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy, College Dropout, Late Registration. Are those the three?
No, Late Registration isn't on here. It's College Dropout, My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy, and I think it's Graduation.
Okay, Drake is on here with Take Care, Cool, and if you're reading this, it's too late. If the project he released to get out of a contract, the one that just had the Lucy's, that's the classic that gets your reversal drive. And it made me think, why does he get snubbed so much? And it's because, listen, I'll say this. Kendrick Lamar came in, and the thing that made him different was his flow and style. People felt like no one sounded like him, and he did that. And now we can see current artists who clearly got influences from Kendrick Lamar, new style.
You say the same about J. Cole, Drake, too.
Hold on. But Drake, to his credit, right? He did the singing rap thing. New style, popularized it, brought it back, whatever, and did it successfully for years to come. Why he always gets involved. J. Cole, I realized the reason he gets snubbed so often is he took something that already existed, like a style of rap that was present, and just did a great job with it. Not necessarily introducing like a completely new a new flow or new style of rap or whatever. He just took what was already there. We see his influences, and he did a great job at it. And he's done a great job at it.
Yeah.
And I realized, because all the new people that I call J. Cole kids, you can easily say, oh, well, I mean, it also could be Nas. It also could be Wale. It could also be, you know, you can't do that with the Kendrick and Drake kids. It's clear, like, okay, yeah, like, you took your influence from Kendrick. J. Cole, the argument is harder. And I get that, and I have to accept that, but I think we should still acknowledge a great album when it's a great album, and Forest Hill Drive, no reason, should not have made this list. No reason.
I agree with you. The thing is, I think to avoid things, if reactions like this, is like, to avoid reactions like Nnamdi just had, I think that albums that weren't obviously like, you know, all across the board, like amazing albums, like, or like that were like, not across the board, like critically acclaimed, but like everything, like everybody should have been on this list, like, because I hear you on the J. Cole thing, but I feel like a lot of these artists, like, even though I love Tierra Whack, I love, you know, whatever, Harry Styles, all those people, if the albums weren't like critically acclaimed across the board from everybody, I feel like they shouldn't have been on this, because me and Avery literally named artists who could have had albums on this, like Jackson 5, I'm surprised they weren't on this list.
Tyler, the Creator, like Tyler, Flower Boy's not on here.
We're not even thinking about recent artists, though. We said like Sublime, Linkin Park,
Duke Ellington.
We literally named a lot of like classic artists who could have had albums on here. So I was like, just to avoid something like that, unless there were like, you know, My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy or something so recent that was such groundbreaking work, I feel like it kind of could have just taken off there. And I know it's tough. It's 500 albums. So I respect you for doing it.
This is too late.
I agree with you. So I was like, if that album's on there, it kind of just lowered the bar for everything else, like below it, honestly. It was like, because I could see albums below
and it
that are way
high.
Better.
Than wasn't it was top 100?
It was like 200. It was like 200 or 300, something like that. It was pretty high, actually. So I'm very surprised on that. But I hear you, Nnamdi, but I feel like to avoid that, if it wasn't just like easily on there, I feel like they could have taken it off. Because Drake, for me, I know people love that album. That album is so like, mixed reviews and people, it's hit or miss for me personally.
Yeah. So okay, well let's for the sake of time, does anyone have any final thoughts on this? Because we
no,
haven't even
good.
Gone into our real topic and I'm pretty
we're good
an hour.
We're good.
So Avery, do you want to introduce this concept that I have dubbed the pandemic winners episode?
Yes, absolutely. So last week I saw on Twitter, I follow a lot of Bad Bunny fans, and I saw that he was doing something pretty unique. He was on top of a bus riding around New York City, performing his album. If I can find it right here, somewhere in here. There it is, right here. Yeah, and it just really got me thinking, like, how are artists staying relevant during this time, during a pandemic, where you can't perform in front of large crowds, where you can't hold concerts or anything like that? It takes someone like a Bad Bunny to do something out of this, like out of this world. Like, this is crazy. This is so cool. Imagine just like being in New York City, Nnamdi, which you will be able to like live out in a week, and you're gonna be able to like look out your window and be like, wow, J. Cole's doing a concert right outside my street. You know what I mean? Like, it's gonna take stuff like this, and you're like, wow, this is so cool. So it really got me thinking, like, as a topic, what if we talked about what are artists doing to stay relevant? What are some of the most creative ways you've seen artists perform, whether it's through like a cross-platform collaboration as like TikTok or Fortnite, or it's literally standing on top of a bus in the middle of the busiest city in the world singing.
Yeah, so can I first say, all I can think of watching this video is, oh my God, I feel so bad for the, look at all the cars behind me.
Oh my God.
All I can think of, if I was the car behind this bus,
Nnamdi
like
was there, guys.
Cars, I would have been livid.
Yeah.
That's all I can think of. Like, was there warning? Okay.
So for the, I really do like this. And I do have to speak on this because I remember at the beginning of the pandemic, I think it was an issue. I'm not going to say an issue because a lot of these big artists are like millionaires, but I remember reading something. It was like, DaBaby was like, man, I lost like $11 million from not touring or something like that. Like a lot of artists found themselves, not saying they're going broke or anything, but like found themselves losing money from, you know, not touring or not, you know, be able to release their album on time, you know, not be able to have the normal, you know, order of operations and whatnot. So I agree with you, Avery, in terms of the fact of artists trying to find a way to kind of, I don't even know if this is monetizing, but just kind of trying to find a way to stay relevant and kind of still be able to bring some normalcy in terms of, performing or whatnot. And also, I'm pretty sure Kendrick did something similar like 5 years ago with like a New York run or something like that, or LA run. But yeah, he did something similar like this where it was like a moving thing. But this is really dope to do this during a pandemic. But yeah.
I feel like my thing is, the clear thing was, okay, so since you can't perform, how are you going to, one, promote your music? Because we saw all the artists delay their projects. And two, make money. Because at the end of the day, like, touring is a huge source of income. Which, by the way, like, to get newsy, like, the touring and the live music industry is still, like, really suffering right now.
Yeah.
But as far, and this kind of, if anything, shows that the only people who can really afford a pandemic right now are the big, big A-listers who can, you know, have the connects to get a gigantic bus and do a performance throughout New York
just
City.
Like a bus. This thing is massive.
And be allowed to, like, and be allowed to.
Be allowed to, and like, because I'm sure this was like, this cost money.
Oh,
but
absolutely.
I feel like for me, the way the people that I think have really done well in the pandemic have been the ones who have been super creative with performing. People who didn't delay their stuff, they still release music, and they just had to think, okay, how are we going to do this? For performing itself, I would say Chloe and Halle, and I wish I had a video of their performance, but we all have seen they've transformed literally their tennis court. By the way, if you didn't know, all those performances apparently happened on their tennis court in their backyard. Transform that into these sites where they've had these huge music videos and like performances that have been really, really great. And I think the artistry in those performances, those are like, well, that's what comes to mind when I think of the people who like, okay, let's think of how we're going to do this in the pandemic, how we're going to stand out, and how we're going to, you know, do our thing.
Go ahead, finish.
I was gonna say, beyond that, the other element and the first one that came to mind is people who Travis Scott, again, forever innovative, and I have the link in the thing, his Fortnite performance, where it was like, this was I want to say, right, it was in the thick of summer, so I want to say maybe like June, it around there, mm-hmm. or April. So never mind. But so clearly
right
not
before
that
summer,
far off the
right
pandemic.
Before summer, though.
Right before summer, yeah. And he did this whole this interactive thing with Fortnite, where you know all the people are playing in the game, and Travis Scott is an actual activation within the game where he's performing. You can like run around him and all this stuff, and like that's cool. And you think about all the audience that he's attracting with that plan. Like you know, I don't know how much money you make off of that thing, but I think the amount of exposure you get, the fact that it set him apart, and like this was the first type of thing I've ever seen of like this.
Well,
it was insane.
I have to say this because this shows. Because I think a lot of things were like, wow, this artist is popular, you know, everybody loves him. But I think this is a great example, this Travis Scott Fortnite thing, is knowing who exactly your audience is and where you can interact with them. Mm-hmm. Exactly. Because, you know, we could say, oh, this artist, you know, we could say, you know, Bad Bunny, I'm not saying, but like, we could say a random artist went to this bus in St. Louis and, you know, they would have ride around and nobody cares because, like, that might not be where their demographic is. But for Travis Scott to go on Fortnite, where a lot of the Fortnite and Travis Scott fans, that world is really intertwined, if you really think about it, in terms of Travis Scott has been very apparent and very, you know, visible on Fortnite in terms of him playing and being on there, him streaming, him playing Fortnite. And a lot of people who play Fortnite love Travis Scott. It's just, I feel like that's just the thing, like those worlds are just intertwined. And for him to have the, like, I guess not, I want to say foresight, but like him to be like, you know what, let's do a performance on Fortnite. That's going to be a big deal because a lot of those fans and a lot of those worlds intertwine in terms of Travis Scott and his fans and how much, you know, how much they listen to his music and him doing a performance on Fortnite. I think that's really interesting. It kind of shows artists like, wow, they really knew who their fans are. Like, do they really know where they're mm-hmm. getting their listens from? So.
Yeah, and that's like, you know, going back to Bad Bunny, he was in New York City, which has one of the highest densities of Latin and Spanish populations mm-hmm. in the country. Yeah. He was riding around places like the Bronx, which also like is one of the boroughs in New York that has one of the higher densities of Latin and Spanish populations. Like, he knew what he was doing, you know?
That's a great
point. On the topic of audiences, just to harken through all the people we've named, even with Chloe and Halle, I feel like they're like Beyonce kids, right? Like Beyonce sort of like the, so those fans are the same, and people have super high expectation for Beyonce performances and videos especially, so I could see why they would also have like super high artistic kind of like videos and performances.
Yeah, and that can't be ignored, especially with artists, because like, you know, we always say this artist is big, everybody loves them, but kind of have knowing where your big artists who are going to actually monetarily support you and actually be there for you, it's actually a really important part about being an artist. We could say, wow, they make great music. That doesn't always mean they're going to make money. You know, you could be like, wow, they're doing a world tour, but are really going to make a lot of money from that? Going, because I've seen artists, and this is not related, it's not related to this exactly, but I remember Brent Fias, I watched this little thing. He's an independent artist, and based off Spotify listens, where they get the biggest density of Spotify lists is how they base their tour off of. So they didn't just tour all the big cities. That's where he bases his listens off of, and where he's touring. So I think it's a big deal for artists to know exactly where and what parts of like the world and country, and you know what city and what part of the city to go, and really, you know, to really monetarily get their support from their fans, which is really interesting. So, yeah.
What other performances did you guys see that you thought were particularly innovative or creative? I have The Weeknd's TikTok performance playing right now.
I was like, that's honestly the one I was going to name as well.
Yeah, I saw you had the Phoebe Bridges performance, which is, I think it's fairly, which is, obviously I'm not the biggest Phoebe Bridges fan personally. You know, that's just me. But Avery's obviously enlightened us.
You don't have to preface that every time you talk about
people. Well, I don't want people to give me trash, because first of all, I think the album is actually pretty good, because I still have songs saved on the album, actually. So for the
record,
it's
like every time her name comes up, it's like,
well, I don't want to sound,
just so y'all know, I don't like her. But Avery,
I didn't say I don't like her. I'm not saying I don't like her, but that her genre is definitely it was definitely an introduction for me. I guess I would definitely say the album is definitely an introduction.
Yeah, for sure, for sure.
So, getting to know her and like her brand and kind of like what she's like, her whole thing is kind of like I don't want to say low budget, but it's really like it's kind of like not her style of music, but I'm talking about her style, like that first music video Kyoto. It was very like off the cuff, not like a lot of like crazy CGI or like something looked super realistic. It was obviously like just her riding around on her green screen, you know, type thing. And that's kind of what she does with her music videos and what she does with her live performances. Like even I remember she did a live performance for like a late night show, Avery. And it was like in her bathroom, and she made
she's
it awesome.
She's in the bathtub. Yeah,
she's in the bathtub, and she made it awesome.
She also did another one where she was driving in her car while singing.
Exactly.
Just because you could.
That's my point. Yeah. Exactly. It's just like really interesting how these artists are like, well, how can I do this? And it makes sense for me. Because if she did something, imagine if Phoebe Bridges did something like The Weeknd just did with like that animated thing. It would be cool, mm-hmm. but it'd be like, oh, that's weird.
Or it'd be like that. Yeah, it'd be off brand.
Exactly.
And what,
exactly,
what we're
exactly.
referencing here is she did a concert at the Red Rocks in Colorado, which is like my dream place to go see the Red Rock Amphitheater.
Oh, you haven't
Colorado.
Been
that's
there,
like
Avery?
No, that's like my dream place to go see a concert.
Oh.
And she did it. Obviously, there are no fans or anything, but she was with her band. They're all socially distancing on stage. And she's just performing her most famous songs and whatever. So it's like you get to watch a concert at like one of the most iconic places to go see a concert in the country on YouTube.
Yeah.
And I also should bring up another way that people have kind of collabed with different organizations and stuff. NPR has been doing their Tiny Desk series from home. Yeah. And they've had, I can look that up here, and they've had many. Like Phoebe Bridgers has been on it, but
Phoebe Bridgers
did one with Billie Eilish.
Billie Eilish, mm-hmm. Benny the Butcher did one at his home.
BTS.
BTS, of course. Yeah, it's been a lot. Norah Jones.
And they've been really killing it here too. John Legend.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, it's been really interesting. And also, I have to say this.
I didn't know they did a Tame Impala one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, oh, yeah. They've done a lot. Tiny Desk is always killing it, though. They're always there quality. They are. And this one's actually pretty recent, too. I actually saw this morning. This is not a lie. This morning, Toby Nwigwe. I remember I asked Nnamdi, have you heard this? Is it Nwigwe or Nwigwe? Nwigwe.
Nwigwe.
Nwigwe. Nwigwe. So the W silent?
Kind of. It's like...
Hey, I got you. And I got an email, and it says, Toby Nwigwe, the pandemic experience. Stream via Houston. And I think this is also just to show the times. All the proceeds from this experience are going towards like COVID related things and stuff like, oh, actually I lied. It's all going, he's donating a portion of proceeds to local indie artists and venues because he is an A+ human. I think that's kind of a joke right there. But just kind of artists kind of also showing what they're passionate about. Cause a lot of times if they're doing stuff where you're getting charged and making money, obviously people are like, wow, why are you charging money? Why are you taking money during this pandemic? But also they're putting it towards, I guess, causes that they care about, which also I think is really important to mention, considering the times we live in and that COVID's still not over. And, you know, COVID's bringing a lot of the, yeah, I mean, a lot of people think it's over, but it's not. And, you know, it gives a chance for artists to kind of shed light on things that they care about, you know, which I think is important. And not every artist has to do something like, you know, Black Lives Matter or something like that. But I do think it's important to, you know, show support and, you know, and monetary support towards, towards causes that they care about and that are important to them, which I think is cool.
Yeah, so I got an email from Ticketmaster last night regarding Glass Animals, a band I really enjoy. Mm. And it says, on sale now, Glass Animals are reimagining their globally renowned live show for the internet. Having used the internet as their playground in pioneering ways while launching their latest album, the event is sure to be a unique use of web as a performance space. And I think this is like, based on the email you got and the email I got, like this sounds like something that's going to be a lot more popular going forward.
I agree. Especially since like people are getting more comfortable with COVID now. You know, yeah. people are traveling, people are still doing things. But I mean, I think it also is like, we had to give these people time to think about how to do this, because I feel like if they would have done something like at the beginning of April, it could have come out really sloppy, could have come out, you know, really unorganized. The quality might not have been there. And from a lot of these like big budget things that we've seen from artists, like the Weeknd thing, those things cost a lot of money. Even Bad Bunny, those things cost a lot of money.
Big teams and like, yeah.
So I think there was kind of like waiting to see proof that this could actually work. Because imagine going to your label being like, yo, I want to do this animation thing. It's like, what's the point of that? That's going to cost $1 million. To be like, yeah, I just want to do it. It's like, you kind of got to see proof that it's going to work and it's going to get actually, you know, some clicks.
I just think we're going to get a lot of music next year. I think that's what I just foresee. I think, because I think the greater majority of artists still are just choosing not to release this year and are going to come out with like fire next year. But I'll also salute the artists who just focus on business. So like Travis Scott and McDonald's, we've talked about him last week, but the people who are like, okay, I mean, well, he's released music too, but also have just like grown other bags while they're doing this pandemic. I'm trying to think of other things. Snoop Dogg with his gin and juice alcohol line. Who else has done stuff?
Someone called the tracksuit collaboration.
Somebody did.
Snoop Dogg also did. I don't know.
Oh, he did that too.
Did he?
Snoop Dogg's always doing something.
So just like people who have like decided to further their bag in other ways.
Well, and we talked with a couple. we talked about a couple weeks ago, the Alicia Keys thing she did with I forgot exactly what it was, but remember she was doing something to I gotta find the headline or something like that. But also artists are like, creating these different things. Oh, and G Herbo, remember he's doing that thing for mental health. I mean, there's artists doing other things. Exactly, that's not necessarily even like, you know, for, to make money. It's just like, wow, let me see where I can make a difference in my own way, in my own creative way. Which
absolutely,
we would also be remiss not to bring up probably the biggest sensation during the pandemic in terms of music, which is Verses.
Absolutely killing it. They are killing it. They had a whole TV show.
I forgot who started that. Was it Swiss Beats?
It's Swiss Beats and Timbaland.
Brilliant. Just absolutely brilliant.
Which is like that honestly is probably the most monumental of all the, like, they're the real pandemic winners versus.
Well, they're basically got a TV show now, right? So like.
Yeah, Apple TV.
and it's amazing. It's awesome. So
any final thoughts? To wrap this up, what other artists would you like to see do something like this? I think Drake's got something creative up his sleeve. Like, he could do something cool.
I'm hoping Drake is silent and we're still waiting on his albums because he's gonna, because he plans on like doing something big. I'm hoping that. Who else has been quiet? I'm hoping Rihanna has something big she wants to come out with.
Don't count on it.
Change the game. No, I don't think. Listen, I think while I do think Rihanna's next album maybe the last we get in a while, I don't think Rihanna.
Well, the last one we got is the last one we got in a while. What you mean?
Yeah, but I think like I think Rihanna has like maybe one or two before she's like,
maybe. You know? I don't know, man. We just had this whole thing about contracts, and Rihanna's a billionaire outside of music.
Yeah,
I would hope she makes music just for the love that the fact that she cares about making music. She loves making music. I do hope that happens, considering Anti was her best album. So I would like to see her grow off that. No, that was her. I think that's her. Well, that's. I think that's her best album, in my opinion.
And I'm just always wanting to debate, so I'm going to say arguably.
Whatever. I mean, it was a top 500, you know. But yeah.
Avery, what about you? Do you have anything you want to see? Anything coming up?
I honestly just like, I just kind of made myself excited to see if like Drake does something after he drops his album.
Yeah,
would you guys pay for like a Drake virtual concert? If it was like
$10-$15.
Oh,
yes. Yeah, I'd do that.
If it was $10 or $15, I would. Yeah, like less than. Can we stop the flex? Yes. If Drake had a $10 virtual concert.
I thought he was gonna say like $50. I was like, heck no, not do that.
He knows
that's a concert ticket.
Yes, he do. Drake would do that.
Now wait, if Kanye did it, would you go?
No.
I want to do it
for him. Because y'all, wait, listen, I know we're done with him, but y'all hear that snippet? For that, whatever. Y'all hear that snippet?
No, Nnamdi, why are we bringing this man up? No. We are not. Listen, I'm not listening to this snippet.
Some can argue that Kanye also was a pandemic winner. Look what he did throughout the pandemic. He ran for president. What did he do? honestly, on a real note, Gap Yeezy. He got that deal, even though I don't know how well that's working out right now. You know, so yeah, let's not. Come on, he's doing something.
How about a pandemic clown? I'm joking.
Okay, pandemic clown of the day. Actually, we know who the pandemic clown of the pandemic is.
Oh, we know that.
We already know who that is.
What a high from that person to a low.
Wow.
He was at the highest of highs at the beginning of the pandemic.
Who just fumbled the entire.
Yeah, who could have won? Yeah, you're right. Who could have won?
He was killing it at the beginning of the pandemic.
Honestly, let's not give him attention because he just, you know.
You're right.
I can't believe he. Oh, you know.
Artists of the week, guys.
Okay, yeah, let's come on. Let's do this. No, go ahead, start us off.
Mad Villain, MF Doom and Madlib. Yeah, man, I just been listening to this album a lot. Yeah, man, really good album.
We highlighted it last week. Go listen to our conversation.
Highlighted it last week, which is actually really good. I know it takes a lot of getting used to. It really is. But this is like, if you're like trying to get into underground rap, this is like the album to kind of listen to, honestly. But yeah. Mad Villain.
Really surprising pick from you over here. You care to
I just honestly, well, I went through a J. Cole rabbit hole because of all the slander I've been getting tossed with week upon weeks. I landed on KOD and I re-listened, and I'm not gonna do this.
I love KOD. It's my favorite.
The album is a great album. Listening to it and I was trying to find the skips and I was trying to find the parts that, you know, would prevent it from being called the great album it is, and the parts that would make people say that J. Cole still hasn't had a classic. And I realized, you know what? I'm just going to sit down and wait, because give me 5 years and we'll be saying J. Cole had two classics. Because KOD is an amazing album, and this my run of listening to it this past week solidified that.
That is a great album.
Photograph, KOD,
Brackets is my favorite.
Brackets is the best song, easily. Easily. And Windowpane. And Windowpane.
Windowpane. Yes. And Friends. See, we're naming half the damn. We already named like half the album. Just go listen to it.
No, the album's great. And I love that it's so concise. Only 12 songs, 43 minutes.
Yeah. You know, he's Avery for high quality work. Yeah,
no, I love that pick, Nnamdi. That's my favorite J. Cole album. So I appreciate it. My pick, my project of the week is Supermodel by Foster the People. This was their second album, and I think it's a criminally underrated pop album.
Criminally?
Criminally. Bro, this thing got, I think it got slammed by critics for whatever reason.
Criminally?
Yes, criminally. I love this album.
I used to get nightmares to Pumped Up Kicks.
Yeah, I mean, Pumped Up Kicks is a messed up song, but this, like, this album is so good, and I don't know why it just got disrespected the way it did, but... watch out for tracks on it.
Was this the one that had the JID one? The JID feature?
No, that came way later. This was their second album. Okay. Yeah, this was like the direct follow-up to Torches. And this was like, this is the album. Everyone's like, oh, they're just one-hit wonders. And I really don't get it. I truly love this album. So,
wow.
Watch out for tracks on it on our 97 demo.
This could be Avery's testing.
This could be my testing.
This could be Avery's testing. Because what if I listen to it and it's late? I'm not going to do that, but... This could be Avery's testing. We'll talk about that later.
Yeah, you guys, this is a good episode. I feel like we got through a lot in our little hour and 10 minutes.
Honestly, the moment you guys competed to say welcome to 97 Demo, we're an hour and 1 minute. So,
are you serious?
Oh, yep. Look at us.
Yo, I'm not gonna lie, that was a solid episode in terms of like
we'll gas ourselves up off mic. Well, but
why not? Nah, but we don't listen to us.
Yeah, and like, you know, continue to subscribe and follow us, because I'll be checking our Twitter account every once in a while and I see that number sticking a little higher.
Yeah, we're just gonna keep sticking with it. We don't care who's listening. We don't care if it's 2 people or 10 people or 50. We're gonna keep trying to put out cool content.
Absolutely.
And have great discussions, because we're the 97 Demo podcast. And listen to the 97 Demo, our 97 demos, because those playlists are solid. I don't care
they
what
really
the
are fire.
Those
Yo, playlists I are play solid. When I go out now and I don't know what to play, I put on a playlist if I'm with
those
friends, and like
playlists
it never,
are solid.
It never goes wrong.
Yeah,
you
man,
know,
those playlists
and,
are solid.
And I tell you the curation and thought that goes into making those playlists.
Well, I made the last one, didn't I? It was solid.
I made the first
414.
If the last one got you hooked, that was Noah.
The last one got you hooked was me.
It's all collabs. So make sure to listen to that. But you guys, that does us for this week of the 97 Demo podcast. Thank you for listening to us, and be sure to continue to look out for our playlist, which is dropping on Monday. Also, we'll be dropping some exclusive stuff throughout the week, so make sure to check out our Twitter. And yeah, we'll see you next week.
Go Falcons.
Shout out to everyone who's been listening to us.
Go Falcons. Get that first win.